everyone. Welcome back to Build. I'm your host, Brittany Jones Cooper, and today I'm sitting down with Denise Bidot. Denise serves as a judge on Univision's reality competition series, Nuestra Belleza Latina, where she also mentors contestants. In addition to the show, she's also a vocal advocate for women, being the first plus-size model to walk multiple runways at New York Fashion Week, and working to help women accept their bodies with her viral No Wrong Way movement. Please put your hands together for Denise Bidot.
Hi, I'm so welcome. Excited to be here.
Hey. How's your day going?
My day's awesome. Yeah. I just flew in yesterday from Miami from our finale. Yes. So it's nice to be back in New York City. It's like chilly and cool and holiday. It's
you like the chilly and cool.
I love it. Oh my God, I live for this season in this city.
Okay, good for you. I hate it. I want to go to Miami.
All you need is a good and you're good.
So let's talk about the show. You just had the finale. I saw everything on social media. It was like so many eyeballs, so much attention. What is that moment like for you? Because you guys, you know, for weeks are building up to this moment.
Oh my gosh. It was intense to say the least. We had amazing like people come in, and we had Pitbull and all these like Bad Bunny and all these people, and I was like, oh my God, but it's still our show, right? And it was insane. We crowned, you know, the contestant this week, McBellis, which is a Venezuelan girl. I think it's the first time Venezuela has ever won the competition. But also she was beautiful in the fact that this season for this show, we eliminated the size restriction. We eliminated the age restriction. And it was our hashtag was sin talla, sin límites, sin excusas, which is no sizes, no excuses, you know, no limits. And I thought that was really beautiful, especially for Univision in the Latin community. So many times the prototype of what is beautiful or thought of as beautiful is so limited and so rigid and so dated, to be fair. And so this girl was an ex-Miss Venezuela and had been bashed and bullied nonstop because she gained a little bit of weight before Miss Universe and pretty much went into this like spiral of depression. And bringing her on and having her audition for this season really represented what we wanted to show in Latin media, that your curves are not limiting in any which way. And so she was beautiful. Every challenge we threw at her, she just came up on top. And it was really beautiful to allow that to happen finally.
For those who haven't seen the show, can you discuss the format a little bit? Because it's like a little mix of different genres.
It's so much going on. Welcome to the Latin community. So this show is actually the longest running reality TV show competition on Univision, which is the number one Latin network in the U.S. But before, for the last 10 years, it actually was structured as a beauty pageant where they had like America's Next Top Model challenges, and it was wild. Like they would make girls walk over fire and swim with like snakes, and like the craziest things would happen. But it was really, really, like I said, just dated in the mentality, and what they pushed out and wanted was one very specific thing. And the modern Latin woman doesn't look like that anymore. So this season was a real change. It was like, how do we modernize what we're putting out on TV and not make people feel alienated or not represented? And so there were Afro-Latinas on the show. One of the contestants was 53 years old. We had a curvy girl, Vanessa, who was on there representing LA and like Mexico. And I thought it was just really beautiful to be a part of that. When they approached me, they were like, hey, how do we do this? Like, what challenges have you faced? What would you like to see? And I think they were really appealing to my generation. People who like maybe are in like in tune with like that old format and who really want to see something different on television. Like I know when I watched it growing up, it was like not representing what I was. So you tune out. And we don't want people to tune out. We want to make people feel included. And so the inclusion was really stellar this year.
Yeah, the inclusion is something that I noticed first. The woman you mentioned, the Afro-Latina named Celine Rosario.
Celine, was our number three girl. I had the chance to walk the runway with her on the finale. She's beautiful. And also what was really cool about her is she shaved her head in our Vegas auditions. And she talked a lot about how in the Dominican world, women are constantly saying curly hair or like more textured hair is bad hair. And so they actually references, I don't think they mean it to be bad, but they're like pelo malo, you know? And so she was like, I'm done with trying to like straighten my hair and do all these extra things. So like when she auditioned in our show, she actually shaved it off like backstage. And we were like, oh my God. And she came out there and walked that runway. And we were like, girl, like you don't need any of that hair. And she kept it short the whole season. And she was so empowering and inspiring to like so many women, even my daughter, like when she would watch her, my little munchkin is Afro-Latina and she's mixed and, you know, doesn't speak that much Spanish. But I think watching this season for her was revolutionary. Like she finally saw herself in Latin media and like now is speaking Spanish. Yeah. And it just goes to show like how deep, you know, this whole thing runs. It's more than just a beauty pageant. It's more than just a contest. This is how we make women feel good and yeah.
I'm seeing that conversation around colorism so much more, and it's so pervasive in so many different communities, in the Black community, Asian community, Latin community. So when I saw these women, these contestants, that jumped out at me too, even though I'm not Latina, to see that representation was so important. So I know for sure it's reaching a whole new generation.
Yeah, it's actually like probably the most rewarding thing I've ever done in my career.
Really? How much interaction you get to have with these girls? Like what kind of advice do you give them? Because they're in this huge stage, and I'm sure that's hard.
Oh my God, I can't imagine what they were going through. It's so scary. We're under a live audience every Sunday night for 2 hours, and they're being judged and doing these crazy challenges and then standing there and walking the runway and being poised and elegant, you know, all while they do this. So I just tried to keep it really honest with them and keep it real as much as I could. I was like, look, girls, this is only a platform. Like, you know, what you do with this is up to you. Don't get caught up in the drama. Do the best that you can. They had, so we had a university this season, the MBLU, where we had, you know, acting coaches come in for them and people to teach them. Some of the girls are more American, you know, and so they would like speak English more. And so we had to work on their like language and dialect and all of that. And so it was really interesting to see them grow throughout the season, because certain challenges you're not going to be great at, but that's okay. Not everything in life can we excel in. And so I was just like, look, keep going. If you sucked at one, just look forward to next week, because next week might be your week. And so it just was something that they just needed to be encouraged and supported. And I think that goes with everything in life as well. Like, you just want a good support system and people who are rooting for you and who want to see you do good. And I wanted every single one of them to reach their highest potential.
Do you think you could have ever been on a show like this?
I am not cut out for a show like that. Look, I love what I do, but I, at the end of the day, like I'm relatively shy, right? And I don't want to put it out all on there, nor do I think that I could live in a house with 10 girls. Like, come on, I'm an only child. Even like a few days out of the week where I'm like, you know, have friends staying over, I'm like, oh God, I like my personal space. I like to like walk around my house, like, you know, in underwear all the time. I don't know how the rest of the girls would feel about that.
That is so, I lived in a sorority and it definitely takes some getting used to. So yeah, that's a lot of pressure, especially then when you're like in the competition and then you have to be on camera. Is there, I know this show has been on for so long. Are some of the women who have been on the show like actresses, or what happens? What's life after the show?
Yeah, I actually think they have they have hashed out some really amazing talent. One of the girls who was hosting our show this season was actually the first winner ever. And Alejandra's show, she does like New Year's Eve in Times Square. She's done like the most amazing things. The last winner that they had actually just finished a movie that has premiered like all over like Latin America, and I think premieres in the US in January, and she's killing it. They've really done excellent. A lot of the talent that they're looking for is curated for the network. So they're like trying to find the next journalist, trying to find the next person to cover entertainment. And so all of the girls, the contestant who just won got a $100,000 deal with Univision. And so where they place her within the network really depends on what shows are out there, but they all have an amazing opportunity. And because it used to be kind of more beauty pageant driven, they were molding Miss Universes and Miss, you know, Miss Dominican Republic or Miss Puerto Rico. And they've had quite a few girls enter Miss Universe and do really, really good. I don't know if they've won, maybe. I don't know. I'd have to fact check that later, but they have entered and done like amazing things. So they do well.
You're such a perfect person to be a judge on a show like this because of your own history with acting and modeling. And so I want to talk about your beginning. How did you get into modeling? And because I'm sure it's been an up and down sort of ride.
Right. So I actually, I thought I was going to be an actress my entire life. I mean, funny enough, now I'm on TV, so it's cool. But you know, when you just grow up knowing you were meant for bigger things. And I remember watching the movie Big Fish when I was younger, and it was like, a goldfish only stays so small if it's in a contained environment, but given a larger place to live. It can be 2-3 times bigger. And I just always felt like I was destined for these great things. And so I moved to LA when I was 18. And I thought that I was going to immediately like get cast in like a movie. Like I was like, oh yeah, for sure. Like I'm going to be so good. Yeah, so easy. I had trained really hard though, to be fair. Like I thought talent would be enough. But what I didn't realize when I got out there is that this was a long time ago. Granted, not the same industry. But back then, I was always curvy. And I was always very Latina and tall. And so I was either too tall, too curvy, too Spanish. So every opportunity kind of closed on me. And I was constantly told, lose 10, 15, 20 pounds and you'd be perfect for the leading lady. And it used to like literally boil me up from the inside because I was like, why can't the leading lady who gets the guy be curvy? Like, I don't get it. And so I was a bit rebellious. And so I was just kind of like, no, I don't want to do that. I'm good. And of course, nobody gave me a job, which was cool because it was all part of the journey. So I started doing makeup. And my mom was like really firm on education. She's like, Denise, I'm not going to have you out in LA doing absolutely nothing. You have to go to school. And so I did makeup school and I started doing freelance jobs. And little by little, I was like, I'll find a way back in front of the camera. And that's exactly how it was. It was totally in a different space I hadn't thought of. I was approached by a photographer when I was doing makeup on a girl. And she's like, have you ever thought of modeling? And I was like, I'm short and chubby. Like, the thought of modeling has never crossed my mind. But this was 12 years ago. Plus size modeling was definitely not, as mainstream as it is these days. And I just took a leap of faith. I was like, you know what? Maybe, like, life is pushing me in a direction I didn't understand. But I wasn't going to close the door on myself. So I walked right through it. And it's been 12 years of the most magical career I could have ever dreamt for myself, and I've learned a lot about who I am, and you know, I've been resilient beyond belief because so many times in our industry people try to tear you down, and I've been able to get back up, which I think is what I'm proud of the most, is like, no, I didn't think there was a limit on what I could do either, and so I just kept pushing forward. And you know, a handful of us who have been in this business for a really long time have done some magical things that have really changed the playing field for everyone, and it's been fun to see myself grow while pushing an industry to grow as well.
Yeah. One of those things is the No Wrong Way to Be a Woman campaign that you started in 2016. I remember seeing it and reading about it, so it's so cool for me to get to actually sit and chat with you about it, because it's something as a young woman that I just exhaled when I saw it. Because
Thank you
grow up trying to fit in all these boxes and told that you're wrong, and it was just nice to hear like, oh no, there's no wrong way.
Thanks. Yeah. I love that. You kind of said it perfectly, because I think that was the thing. When I walked the runways in 2014, I think I had done something that people had never seen before. And I started getting all these questions, you know, how is plus size modeling different from straight size modeling? How are you confident? And I was like, there's not like a real science to it. You just got to like look yourself in the mirror and know you're enough, you know, and you know you're worthy of these successes and triumphs. And at the time, there were no platforms kind of relaying that message to anyone else. And I felt it my duty, you know, considering all the DMs and messages that I would get from women across the world, you know, sharing their stories or telling me how my stories changed their lives, that I wanted to make it a bigger thing. And so we launched the No Wrong Way movement, and in doing so launched merch, because I thought it's funny. A lot of times we can't vocalize our truth, right? And so I just wrote on a shirt, there's no wrong way to be a woman. And I started getting orders across the world, from Australia to Germany to Brazil. And I'm like, how wild is it to think that people, you know, they may not be able to speak their confidence or feel it just yet, but sometimes just wearing it in a baseball cap or a t-shirt like makes you feel a certain sort of way. And I had so many girls be like, I wear it to the airport all the time and I get so many compliments. But then I was like, okay, so this is bigger than that. I ended up having a lot of men who reached out and were like, how do we get involved? Or like my daughter and her friends were like, I want to be a part of it. So I realized that calling it the No Wrong Way, there's no wrong way to be a woman, was almost limiting its potential. So I rebranded to the No Wrong Way movement, included men in the campaign, started doing YouTube videos that like let people like speak for themselves. You know, it's not about me. It's about bringing people together to just be authentically themselves, whatever that looks like, and just allowing a platform to make people feel safe and included and understanding that they're beautiful beyond measure.
And like you said, it's beyond just size. When you look at the campaign, there's women of all different colors. There's women with disabilities, different hair. It's just like so encouraging. So is that the message that you just want to put out in the world?
Yeah, it's just about feeling good and finding your happy place, you know? And so many times we put these exterior things as priorities and we don't realize that they don't matter at all. You know, we're all going to get old. We're all going to get wrinkles. Things are going to drop. And if you don't feel good about yourself now, what are you waiting for?
Sometimes I think that that's part of the issue too, is mothers and grandmothers sort of passing down their own insecurities. I've seen it with a lot of my friends. And so you have a little girl. How important was it for you to face your own stuff so that you didn't pass that on to her?
Oh my God. Well, that was, I think, when everything changed for me. My mother, ironically, as you speak, suffered a lot with who she was and her identity within her body. And she yo-yo dieted my entire life and, you know, would binge eat and even suffered eating disorders. But because she was a single mother and I was an only child, I got to experience that firsthand. And I always knew that I didn't want to suffer in the same way myself, which is why I was like, no, I'm good. I don't feel like changing and I'm going to be okay like this. But interestingly, when I had my daughter, I was kind of just at the beginning of my career and I was trying to figure out, you know, who I was and after kids, you know, like your body changes, everything's different. You're trying to find your sexy groove back and like your confidence back. And I was like, I can't let her see me sweat. You know, I have to show her what it looks like to be confident, what it looks like to love yourself, what it looks like to succeed and fight for your dreams. And so she was the biggest inspiration to just keep pushing forward once, you know, once I had her. And I'm so thankful that I did because she's such a mirror of me and she's such a like confident, sassy young girl. She's 10 and she's like everything I am now at 10. So like, I can't imagine, you know, what the future holds for her, because if we allow ourselves to just be happy, that next generation gets it. They're so smart. And like, I see them growing and like just being exposed to so many different things, even just technology and just the world. Their access to anything is right in their hands. So like, if we raise them to be confident, like imagine the lawyers or the presidents of like 10, 20 years from now. So we shall see. Hopefully she got it all figured out.
Well, and she still has so much time. That's why it's awesome. And you can see the trends changing. You're seeing more women going without makeup. You're seeing more and more models resist retouching, which I think for me has been one of the biggest things. And I know you have personal experience.
Oh my God, retouching is such a thing in our world. I swear to you, the first like 5 years of my career, like I don't even know who the girl in the pictures was. Like I was like, oh, cute. Like it's me, but it's like the outside of me and my face, but everything in here was this like other person. And so you guys know exactly what I'm talking about. You look at the girl in the streets and you're like, that is not the same model. But granted, like we're working for someone. They're trying to create an image that they're going to sell to people. And for many years, the thought was that you needed to be perfect. You know, you couldn't have an imperfection. So I think social media has been so powerful in that. I remember the first picture I posted, like unretouched. I was like in a bikini and I was for a very long time wearing high-waisted bikinis, but I was like, oh, this day I felt sassy and I was in Miami and I had a low-cut bikini. And I was like, I looked down, you know, you're tan and you look down. I'm like, I don't look so bad. So I put the camera up and like I took a picture and I was like, I want to post this. And like, I wonder how people will respond. And I remember sharing it, and it was like one of my highest like viewed and commented images ever. And it wasn't this perfect visual of me. It was so real. People almost didn't know how to process it. But I think it was interesting because after that, brands started hiring me to do unretouched images. And my agency at the time was like, oh, no, you got to take that down. They're like, they're going to see you, and it's going to limit you from like getting jobs and doing all these things. And at the time, I had clients be like, hey, so she's going to cost a little more in post-production work. So like, can we take a lower rate? And I was like, ew, like, no, like, if you want someone who's perfect, go find that girl. Like, does she exist? I don't think so. So keep looking. And we've changed some things. I've been able to be in Sports Illustrated unretouched, which is beyond wild to me. Like, in my thoughts, I'm like, are you kidding right now? Like, my mom opened that and all her coworkers, and like, look at Denise in her like bikini and her stretch marks and cellulite. And I was like, damn, we've come a long way from like those first shoots that I did where like nothing about me was perfect, you know? And now just being able to be free in my body and what I represent is like the best part of it. It's a cherry on top.
We've come a long way, but are there some areas that you still see neither fashion or modeling that you're like, we need to do better?
There are always going to be things that we can do better in, right? And it's just about having the conversation be open and never making someone feel like you're bashing them for not being there yet, right? I think when we in this journey of like our acceptance and this revolution that we're kind of living, we've almost pushed further than fashion allows. So we were like, oh, inclusion, inclusion, inclusion. And then fashion brands are like still trying to catch up. You know, even for me, like I talk about this all the time. I thought that when I got to a level of success, I would be able to dress myself however I wanted. And I was like, oh, I'm going to be able to buy this and get this. And then I got there and I was like, oh, that doesn't exist in my size. That sucks. So, like, I just encourage designers to keep trying, expanding sizes and, you know, fitting things on curvier women and showing them in advertisements. Like, we're starting to see the same outfit shown on a smaller girl and a bigger girl. And I think that's really beautiful. And when I see that, I purchase, you know? I want people to understand that there's so much room to grow and we're being as patient as we humanly can, but we want to shop too.
And that's why I love, I've seen so many women in different industries and entertainment start their own brands. They're like, I'm not waiting, you know, now's the time. So that's also been a positive.
Absolutely. Event. I want more women to step up and create their own businesses and be the, like the ad agency execs and, you know, represent on different fields. It's not just about being in front of the cameras. The moment we get to that level of inclusion is when the boardroom changes.
Exactly. I'm all for that. Let's make that happen next year.
Hell yeah.
All right. All right. I think we have a couple of questions before we go out of, get out of here. Do you go first?
Yes. My question is,
hi.
Say hi.
Hello.
Yeah, how are you? The question is, I watched your empowerment speech on Realize Your Beauty Day in 2017. And I know you spoke about your mom, the difficulties of, in her era, being thin was everything. I wanted to know, where did you get your undenying confidence from? Was it a moment or was it gradually?
That's a great question. My mom is the core of everything that I do. She's been my biggest inspiration, but she's also kept it so real with me that I learned a lot when I was growing up. I do remember it was a moment. We used to go to the Pizza Hut buffet every like Wednesday, right? And it was like a thing and we'd go there and we would just eat and we'd eat the food and then we'd eat the dessert. And then on one day I remember I went to the bathroom, my mom went to the bathroom and I like ran after her just to tell her something and I caught her throwing up. And I will, that moment for me, like it's so funny because I talked to her about it recently and she's like, oh my God, like I never processed that you like realize what was going on. But I must have been like 10, 11 and I saw like, to me, the most beautiful woman in the world, like literally hurting herself to be thin. And I was like, holy crap, like my mom has a problem and like how do I fix that or how do I not end up a victim of that, you know? And I remember at that very moment looking at her and being like, you're so beautiful and you don't get it at all. And I think that was the moment that I decided to never walk down that same path and to let the self-loathing really just end with me. Like, I'm like, I'm good. No, thank you.
And isn't that amazing that you have a 10-year-old now and you're aware of how much she's aware of, you know? And so that's just, wow. Oh,
all parents really need to know that children know. Yeah. They know what you're putting out there. You know, you can tell them a million times they're beautiful and they're perfect, but if when they see you look at yourself, you're not relaying that same message, they're not going to get it.
Absolutely. Next question. That was a great question.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, how you doing? My question is, who inspired you and will you be doing a new season?
Oh, so we just wrapped on Sunday, so there are a lot of really exciting things in the pipeline that I can't necessarily speak of right now. I do hope that they renew the show for us for our next season because it did so good in the final ratings, and I think that sort of television needs to be on all televisions, you know, not just Latin media. But the biggest inspiration for me was my mom, you know, my mom and my grandma, my whole family. I come from a family of, like, boss Latina women. And, you know, my aunt's a doctor. My grandmother, like, you know, went to the ends of the world for her family and, like, always just treated us with so much love and kindness. And I think beyond just being really amazing businesswomen, they always kept their humility and just always understood that family comes first and, like, being a good human being. And so for that, I'm so thankful.
And last question.
Hi.
Hi, hello.
So what has been the most memorable moment for you being a judge on this show?
Okay, so I loved every part of the show. It was such a cool experience to have like a live studio audience every Sunday night. My Sundays were so boring before the show, and like then every Sunday became like super glam fabulousness, and I lived for that because I am a very, very sassy Latin woman. But I think my most memorable moment from the show just happened on Sunday. I got the chance to walk the runway with Celine. And I had this like amazing blondes like piece, which I am obsessed with the blondes, and the fact that they let me wear this was magical. But I thought what was really beautiful is they had her as an Afro-Latina with a shaved head, you know, walking the runway along me, who's curvy and short and Latina. And then you look at that and you're like, that's never been seen on television ever. And it was the same night as the VS show. So getting to walk the runway on Sunday night was really awesome because it just proved that that is beautiful as well. And, you know, there's no limit to how we are, how we push out there in this world, right? And so there was a beautiful article that Univision actually wrote after kind of pointing out that moment. And we're standing, you know, back to back, and the camera's kind of going around us. And I'm like, oh, my God, that's the future right there. It's crazy. So that was a lot of fun.
Thank you.
That's really powerful, and I love the internet because you can go watch all of this online. I actually got like through most of the finale, so if you guys missed it, you can still check it out.
Yes, they can.
And I just want to thank you for being here. This is one of my favorite conversations to have. I think it's so important for women to support other women and to just like build that positivity through generations. Like you're Absolutely. Reaching your daughter, but you're also like touching so many other women around the world.
Oh
so,
my God, let's yeah. all keep paying it forward and being good humans.
That's what I'm saying. So thank you guys. Give it up for Denise.
Thank you.